How y'all doing?
This is a thrill. This is a thrill.
Hoping to get in our bikinis for this screening.
No kidding. I know. First of all, I've known you for quite some time, but this is the first time I've seen you in a long
time. We were trying to figure out the last time. I think it was at The View.
I think it was at The View, too.
Yeah, but you don't come out much anymore.
No, I know. Well, you're living here now.
I am. Oh, I've been living here for a long time, I very much appreciate my quiet time, and I live up on the top of a mountain with my new husband, who is a mountain rock.
He certainly is. That's a climbable guy.
Yeah, no, but I'm so proud of this movie. I can't believe it's been 35 years. It's just my greatest honor to be here and talk about my experience.
How fast has it gone by?
I'm sorry? It flew.
It flew. Because, look, I was asking you earlier, you grew up in Hastings in New York, and you came into the city early on in your childhood and did a lot of shows, like cabaret shows.
Oh, yeah.
We all did.
Yeah. I did nothing, but I learned stage presence. I was studying singing. I wanted to be a performer.
You can't teach stage presence. You
really
have it.
Really?
And thanks. You do.
Thank you.
That's the truth.
I did. I wanted to be a performer. And Hairspray is one of those things that I had never heard of John Waters. I had never heard of Divine. All I heard from my freshman year, it was finals week at Ithaca College, the armpit of upstate New York, and I heard that they were looking for a fat girl who could dance, and I was like...
That's how this happened?
Yeah,
open call?
Open call. They'd been looking. This is in 1987. I was 18 years old, and we had a break between finals, so it was a five-hour drive to New York City. I drove down. I got a speeding ticket on the way.
And that was good luck.
It's good luck. It turned out to be.
Yes, it was.
But I was pretty pissed at the time. But I met John Waters in the first audition. And again, I didn't know who he was. I thought he looked weird with that mustache. And I was wearing a giant Ithaca College sweatshirt. And you see the movie. My tits were as big as your head, people. And, he was looking over the desk. He told me afterwards he was trying to see if I was really that big or if I had, like, made my... And I was like, no, it's all me. And I had a callback, and I got to dance for that callback, and he picked me, and it changed. To say it opened every door is an understatement. I don't know what I would be doing if John Waters didn't.
You didn't know who he was. You didn't know who Divine was. Did you then watch all of his movies?
No, he wouldn't let me.
What?
He didn't want me to change my performance. So, of course, I'm hearing on the set, and, it's all the Dreamland family, all the crew are all the people that work with him over and again. It's a real family.
But your performance fit the tone of this movie, and all of his movies have a certain tone.
Yes.
They're all very heightened. And what you were doing landed you this role.
And I think that's how I got
the
part.
That's how
it
happened.
I said the lines in the first audition the way he had imagined them being said. He didn't have to correct me. And it was just... it was beshert, It was totally meant to be because I feel like I was that character. That was my hair, by the way.
Was it really?
That is all my hair. In the beginning, I wear a brown wig, and then when I dye my hair, that's my hair. It was never the same.
After.
I bitch and moan about it. Those of you that know about my hair loss journey, this was part of it. But
really?
I would have done it again in a heartbeat. Yeah,
of
it was
course.
Worth it.
And the cast is crazy. I mean, did you know who Deborah Harry was?
I knew her. I remember going to Jewish day camp and listening to her album, the Blondie album.
Okay, of course.
Yes, of course. I knew Sonny Bono. I didn't know who Motormouth Maybell, Ruth Brown.
Ruth Brown,
I wasn't
the
familiar.
Great Ruth Brown.
Such a great performance. Oh. I mean, everyone. And all the kids were actual kids that we were all having to, learn how to dance, in between shooting scenes. Jerry Stiller,
Of course.
Jerry Stiller was so wonderful.
One of the greats.
Was so wonderful. And I got to work with him on King of Queens as well.
He was an amazing man. I went to college with his daughter, Amy.
Oh,
so
Amy,
I knew Ann and Jerry for years. And Jerry used to come see me perform all the... He was the kindest.
Immense. Yeah.
Oh. So what about Divine? What was that like, working with...
Okay,
Divine.
So Divine wasn't necessarily a fan of mine in the beginning. He didn't know who I was, but he wanted to play both parts, like in Female Trouble. So he was very disappointed that John didn't let him play Tracy. And so he, had to get used to it. And I remember, meeting him at the Belvedere, whoever is from Baltimore, let's give Danny Oceanhorn, at the Belvedere Hotel. Divine was living there, and I remember meeting him, and I had heard so much about him. And, he was a little bit standoffish, and then he warmed right up to me and was showing me how to walk in heels. No, honey, do it this way, And by the end, he was saying, oh, Ricki, let's eat a pie. Let's share a roast. He loved to have an eating companion.
He was intimidating. I met him once. I was doing stand-up in Provincetown, Massachusetts at 19 years old, and he was doing The Neon Woman, written by Ron Link, in a cabaret there. And he was, I was afraid to say hello, and I loved him, but I...
Wait, what year was that?
It was 1979.
Okay. Okay, so
I'm 97,000 years old.
And what, did he hit on you?
No, he didn't hit on me. I was adorable and cute. No, he didn't hit on me. No, he didn't. He didn't say anything to me. I didn't say anything. I was working with people like Craig Russell, who was a genius female impersonator, and Maxine Andrews of the Andrews. It was this crazy summer in Provincetown. But anyway, enough about my history.
I digress.
That's enough. Okay, so, but he ended up really liking you.
I loved him.
And I think the fact that he didn't play twins added, because I think Polyester was the first John Waters film that kind of slightly crossed over with the Smell-O-Rama. And then this one really, Hairspray was his first
PG,
big commercial hit, PG.
Yeah.
And I think part of it was you. I mean, you, and being youthful and playing. I mean, if he had played both parts, it would have changed the whole movie.
But he does play two roles.
Oh, he does. He plays the TV
male.
Guy.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, the TV executive.
Yeah. To think that Divine passed 8 days after this movie opened. You know, it was literally, and he was doing an episode of Married with Children.
Yep.
I want to say he died not far from this hotel. He was staying in a small hotel right near here, and he was doing an episode of Married
with Children. He was in rehearsals for that,
He was in rehearsals, and he didn't wake up. He was 42 years old. Like, it's so hard to wrap my head around that. And to think what his career would have done after Hairspray, it's something I still haven't gotten over.
Again, it was the first commercial hit. And it was starting to, just going on Married with Children at that time frame was a big deal.
Yep. And I remember they sent, at his funeral in Baltimore, the Married with Children cast sent flowers, and it said, if you didn't want to be on our show, why didn't you just tell us? Yeah. And, Whoopi Goldberg sent something. I can't remember what she said. But, yeah, I mean, it was a shock. And for me, I was suddenly this big star, and I was having all my dreams come true, and it was just attached to this tragic piece of it as well. It was just this both emotions.
It's a bittersweet thing.
Absolutely.
So your history with John continued after that. You did Cry Baby,
yeah.
And
that was so much fun. It was, I wasn't the star of that one, but I was working.
But you were great in it. It's
three and a half
movie.
Months, and we did mostly night shoots, and we lived in this tiny hotel, all the actors, all the cast together, Susan Terrell, Johnny, Iggy Pop, Patty Hearst is hanging out in the bar at 7 a.m. with us. It was so, Joey D'Alessandro. It was the Mink Stole, of course, Troy Donahue. It was incredible. Tracy Lords, she fell in love with the prop master on Cry Baby and married him. It's wild.
John Waters, he takes people from the past and brings them into the light again.
And changes
like Troy
their,
Donahue. And,
yeah, yeah. He changes up their persona, And for me as well, he's just been such a mentor to me. I've been in this business now for 35 years, and I think I've managed to stay grounded and relatively normal because of his kind of giving me my start,
Because he comes from this kind of cult movie making that's built from the ground up with hardly any money, and I don't think he ever forgot where he came from or changed who he was.
He's exactly as you think he is. I'm sure you've probably seen him live in his shows. He's just so unique. He's so brilliant. He's so loyal. He's so loyal to his people, and I just revere him. And I hear he's making another movie.
He should. He should keep going. He hasn't made enough, as far as I'm concerned.
It became really hard. It's like Serial Mom. What's his last movie? A Dirty Shame. A Dirty Shame. Yeah.
And what you did? You were in Serial Mom.
Serial Mom. I played the daughter in that movie.
Did you enjoy working with Kathleen Turner?
Enjoy is maybe not. The word. I was a huge fan of hers, but she was intimidating.
She's intense.
I think it's safe to say she didn't want me as her daughter to play her daughter because she didn't. I was 24 at that time. I was about to start my talk show, which was hilarious, guys, because I'm on the movie set and I'm telling Suzanne Summers, "Oh yeah, I'm about to do my own talk show," and she was like, laughing at me in the corner. Like,
she had her talk show.
Yeah, and she was just like, "Oh really? Nice little girl. You're doing a talk show," and it was just very funny that my talk show ended up being a big hit, but. but Kathleen didn't like the idea of a 24-year-old playing her daughter.
Well, what did she want? Oh, she wanted like a 12-year-old?
She wanted like a teenager.
Well, You look like a teenager. You were at 24 as a teenager.
I looked really young, and it worked for the film, and she, you know, she got over it.
Well, I know her from the theater world, so yeah. That's you.
I mean, she's a legend.
I am a legend.
And she kills it in that movie.
I was quite good in that picture, Serial Mom.
She was amazing in Serial Mom.
She was brilliant.
Yeah, no one else could play that part.
And, you know, on stage, she's one of the great actresses of all time.
Oh, yeah. Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, right?
She was robbed of the Tony Award that year.
Yes, yeah. She was. And Sam Waterston, who played my father, who I loved, and Matthew Lillard. And
I love that movie.
Ming Stoll is so funny in it. Again, these John Waters movies, they hold up all these years
later. They do. And when you watch his filmmaking from beginning to end, to see the progression of it and to see where it went, and, you know, you get more money and you get to do other things, but... The stuff he did early on, Female Trouble is one of the greatest.
Of the early films, I think that's my favorite, too.
I agree.
Don Davenport and those cha-cha heels. And
I want
my favorite line in that movie is when she looks up and she's all scarred. Pretty, pretty. Yeah, it holds up, guys.
It really does.
Yeah.
It does. So you got two kids now.
They're men.
I know.
Where did that time go?
They're
hairy men and they live in New York. I know Milo is 26 and my youngest is going to be 22. Yeah, and I just got married and Ross has 4 adult children.
It's the Brady Bunch.
We're living the dream, you guys. We're living the dream.
And we were talking earlier about how Tracy Turnblad has really influenced your life and your attitude through life and how you kind of handle things.
I just think the character, creating that character with John... It just has lived on, like to be that underdog and to be speaking up for the marginalized and for inclusivity. You know, it's just an important message that who knew it'd be as relevant.
Oh, and talk about ahead of its time. It's so relevant today.
It's unbelievable.
It's all about diversity and inclusivity, and that's what this movie's all about.
And I think being a talk show host afterwards, I think because people were rooting for me as Tracy, I think it helped in getting into that role and being trusted and, you know, being like the girl next door. Your character was the
leader of that diversity and including everybody. It's me. And also, I had the soundtrack. I played the soundtrack. The choices of music that John uses in it's stuff that you may have heard in the past or it wasn't like crazy like top 10 hits, really.
He always would handpick the music that he would put in his films, like Crybaby. Yeah, no, and Hairspray, the soundtrack to Hairspray is incredible.
It's great.
And Madison. He would send me, I have a VHS tape of John Waters. It was just him by himself with the shadow of him. It's black and white, of him teaching me all the dances. It was sent to me to learn before I got to Baltimore. I'm going to have it digitized or whatever you have to do.
Digitized.
Like, I have to. It is so funny. Yeah.
Did you dance for him? I did.
And I didn't know, you know, like I was 200 pounds. I could fake it, you know, but I was not a trained dancer.
Yeah, but you moved really well.
Thank you.
You really did. Do you like the musical?
Hairspray.
Yeah.
Yes. I actually love it. When it first started, I went to the opening at Broadway and I just was, you know, I'm a singer. I started at the, at Don't Tell Mama and... So for me, seeing this young girl take over my part, you know, when I didn't have the opportunity to audition for it.
That was a little horrifying.
I was doing my talk show at the time, and I was in my, you know, whatever, I was 20, or I was probably 26, 27 when that came out. And it was just hard to swallow this thing happening without me. And I even said to John, can I audition? He's like, you're not fat and you're too old. I think that's verbatim, and it's exactly the tone. And so I had to let it go. And so it took a while, but of course it's. Of course I'm so proud of the fact that it turned into what it, you know. She won the Tony. I used to joke that she won my Tony. But I love Marissa. I love Nikki Blonsky. I love Maddie Baglio. All of them played this role so beautifully.
It's a good movie musical too.
Yeah.
I like the movie musical. I like John Travolta.
I mean, it's great. It's great. But I think the original is always the best.
Oh, no. The original, there's nothing better.
That's my, you know.
Nothing.
I'm biased.
When you see it again after you've seen the stage and the movie musical, you just go, yeah, this is... And like I said, it's kind of... When Mark Shaiman and Scott Whitman watch this, they probably were like, this is begging to be a musical. But it kind of is already... Because there's so much great music.
Yeah, people think I sing in this. I'm like, no, I didn't sing. I got to sing in the remake. I got to sing on the soundtrack.
But
how many of you have not seen the film? Anybody seeing it for the first time?
Oh, you're in for a treat.
Ooh,
you're in for a treat. It's a great, great movie. Well,
My friend Emmy is seeing it for the first time.
I'm seeing it for the 90th time. So I could talk to you forever.
It's such a pleasure. Thank you so much for having me. I hope you enjoy it.
Enjoy the movie.
Let's roll the